wrong from right. Learned a long time ago, things ain't always black and white. Just like you can't judge a book by its cover, we all gotta be careful how we treat one another. Everybody just the way you want them to treat you.
At all, when the mountains look so big and my fate just seems so small, so call me Jesus, 'cause I'm shaken like a leaf. You have been my key of glory. Won't you be my Prince of Peace? So hot inside my soul, there must be blisters on my heart. So call me Jesus, 'cause I'm shaking like a leaf. You have been my King of glory. Won't you be my Prince of Peace? So Linda, don't come that cruel to me. I'd rather fight you for something I don't.
we all find grace. Come on now. Bet you wanna sing hallelujah.
Bet you say amen.
Church. I'm grabbing this great big book. I'm going to read it to you. No, I'm not. Just kidding. This was my devotion this morning over my morning coffee. It said, most people wish to serve God, but only in an advisory capacity. So I share that with you because this was given to me by a very dear friend who knows me pretty well. And I know that it's hard to sometimes hear from the Lord because we live in a very busy and noisy world. There's a lot of noise, a lot of stuff that doesn't really matter. So I'm hoping that as you come in today that you're here to, instead of advise, receive from Him the blessing, the blessing of relationship and worship, and how that will carry you through the following week, to just know that you've got that connection anytime you want it. So if you will stand, we're going to rock through Soul on Fire, and hopefully your soul will be on fire this week for the Lord.
Thank you. God in prayer with me. Dear Heavenly Father, today is full of endless opportunities for those gathered in your name. Let us give thanks for those gathered here today. Remember those who cannot be with us. Look with welcome to those who have yet to find this way. You equip us and encourage us on this journey as we work to build a community that embodies the love that you are. Let us not grow weary. Give us the words and heart and spirit to keep going. When a need arises, let us meet it. When a pain is felt, let us work to heal it. When a storm is raging, let us offer shelter and peace. Let us not be resistant to the stirrings of our hearts, shifting of our minds as you lead us to our growing edges. Your work was not promised to be easy, to fill our hearts and make your kingdom here on earth. Let your Son rise again among us. Even when we are weary, he will help carry our burdens and renew our sense of purpose. In him there is rest for our souls. We ask all of this in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I just had a moment when I said temptation, and I hiccuped. And I thought, oh, I'm so familiar with that prayer, and I hiccuped on temptation. That's not good. But isn't that the truth? We're so familiar with things that we don't think about them. The Lord's Prayer, I admit, is one of them. And I am so thankful for those moments when I can pause and really think about what I'm saying and what I'm asking for. And so you know the parts that are going to come, right? You know what I'm going to tell you. There's ways you can give. There's baskets on your tables. I wish we could share with you each and every soul that those gifts touch. But the ones that you're most familiar with are your own. When you give freely, you are the one who's being blessed. And then we have that light that shines in the darkness. And I tell you every week, it cannot be extinguished. And do remember that. No amount of huffing and puffing and blowing on something to blow it out will ever extinguish what Jesus has to offer you. And the cross back there can hold whatever burden you have. Write it down, hang it up, know it will be prayed for, and know that you can truly unburden your heart and your soul. And finally, come to this table, or that table, or that table, for that fuel that only he can offer. And I invite Debbie forward for the words of institution.
And on that night so long ago, Jesus sat in an upper room with his friends and his disciples, and they had a meal together. At the end of the meal, he took the bread, and he broke it, and he said, this is the bread of life, my body broken for you. And then he took the cup, and he blessed that, and said, this is the blood of the Spirit. Take and drink, and be with you for all. Come to the table.
Thank you.
Here comes a workman.
How many of you are generally comfortable in this season of your life? Just generally comfortable. Good, you're in the right place because I am here to afflict you. How many of you are going through a period of affliction? Things are difficult, a little bit difficult in some areas. Some of us, it's pretty hard. Not as many hands go up. For some reason, we're not as ready to confess that out loud. But you're in the right place too, because I'm here to comfort you. They say that every message should afflict the comfortable and comfort the afflicted. And this is one of those passages where Jesus' message had the power to afflict the comfortable and to comfort the afflicted. The great paradox of this life is when we are walking in grace, we will experience certain afflictions. And if we're not walking in grace, even if we have anesthetized ourselves, numbed ourselves from various afflictions, doesn't mean that we are not afflicted. This morning, we are continuing with our theme for this summer, One Great Summer, and we're going to be discussing one great invitation. I'm going to give you a little bit of context for the passage that we're getting ready to read from Matthew. People are watching Jesus, and there have begun to be several followers. John the Baptist has pointed to Jesus as the one. John has found himself in some seriously afflicted circumstances, facing certain death. He's been arrested, he's been imprisoned, and he knows in all likelihood he will be essentially assassinated. And he sends some of his followers to ask Jesus, "Are you really the one? I've pointed to you and this hasn't worked out so well for me. Are you really the one?" And so this passage in large part is about how we see God, how we see God's messengers, what prevents us from seeing and understanding God. It's kind of like the world in which we live today. There are many authorities, there are many spokespersons on behalf of God, many of whom are claiming to see God clearly and accurately. You think about it. In this town of 10,000, how many churches are there? And why are there so many churches? I think there's actually some good reason for different spokespersons. And I do believe that there are people who look differently, they speak differently, they have different language, vocabulary, their appearance is different. And we see a little bit of this in the passage today. So let's go there right now, because you see it immediately. Matthew chapter 11, verses 16 through 19, then we're going to pick up in verses 28 through 30. But why will I compare this generation? It is like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another. We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We wailed, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners, yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds. They came in very different appearances, in very different ways, both announcing the coming reign of God. It's not always about appearances. Jesus says this, come to me, all ye, you can hear my background, right? All you that are weary, and what do many of us think of? And heavy laden, right? Sometimes these different translations, we'll find ourselves fumbling over some of these newer translations. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. May our lives be transformed by the reading, hearing, understanding, and internalizing of these powerful words. What prevents us from seeing God clearly? What prevents us from hearing the message of God in the way that God desires for us to hear the message of God? One of the things that Jesus is addressing in this particular passage, and I've selected parts, as you can see, we jump from verse 19 to 28 for time's sake. But one of the things he's addressing is pretentiousness. Pretentiousness. I think that's one of the great stumbling blocks, as it is said, of us seeing God as God is. Pretentiousness is often thought of as arrogance. But I wonder also if there's a measure of insecurity in pretentiousness. This invitation that Jesus offers is from first to last an invitation into a life of grace. And for far too many of us, we think it's the case that we have to clean ourselves up, we have to get ourselves to a particular place so that God will accept us. One of my dear friends whose parents were my godparents growing up, he's the lead pastor of a church now that has satellite churches. It started with a group of people before they ever had a meeting place, and now their particular site holds a couple of thousand, and around Christmas and Easter, they have to have services beginning on Saturday that continue into Sunday and go into Sunday afternoon. And one of their main themes is that they are ordinary people living extraordinary lives. I love that. And it's based on those early disciples when they were called into account about their witness. These were ordinary people who were living extraordinary lives. One of the things that inspired my friend Paul was the churches he grew up in. And I attended, as many of you know, I didn't attend church growing up, but I attended church with Paul occasionally. And one of the things he noticed was that people who needed access to God, who needed access to Jesus, unfortunately were unlikely to encounter God in church. Isn't that a strange statement to make? That people were unlikely to encounter God in church. Because in order for them to go to church in the first place, they felt like they had to measure up. They felt like they had to possess the right attire. They felt like there couldn't be any area in their lives that were out of bounds. So in order to approach God, they had to get all of that straight. Before they could go to church, they had to get their lives straight. But that's not how God operates, is it? The grace of God is not one in which we get ourselves to a certain place so that God accepts us. The grace of God is the recognition that God has accepted us already. Once we realize that we are accepted, we are then inspired to change. We do not change so that God will accept us. Because God has accepted us, we have this innate desire to change. Let me put it this way. We do not change so that God will love us. Because God loves us so much, we have this desire to change. Our desire to change is not for fear of the alternative. Our desire to change is because we love God. God does not desire our obedience out of fear that God will punish us. That's not loving God, is it? If what we do is what we do because we are afraid of the alternative, that's not loving God, is it? God desires that we love God. Here's the beauty. Once we know how much God loves us, we cannot help but to love God in return. Now our transformation takes place because of how much God loves us and because of how much we love God. Another hindrance to us seeing God as God is. I know I make that statement so often, and I fear that I make it so often that it might ring hollow, but nothing could be further from the truth in terms of our pursuit of God. We want to know God as God is. That should be one of our fundamental prayers. And one of the things that gets in the way is our orthodoxies and our orthopraxies. What do I mean by that? Part of what divides churches is the set of orthodoxies to which the disparate churches adhere. Now, why do I say disparate? Even if we are fractured as the one body of Christ, we can never be separated. Even though there are multiple denominations, many of whom won't claim one another, there is only one body of Christ. That's not something we're just trying to practice here at First Christian Church. There's only one body of Christ. But what fractures us in our current condition is often our orthodoxies. What do I mean by orthodoxies? In the movement that we call the Christian Church Disciples of Christ, there was a gathering. It was a revival. And at that revival, there were Methodists and Baptists and Presbyterians and Independents. The founders of our denomination were Presbyterians. And there was what they called the Westminster Creed, their orthodoxy, the doctrines to which people had to adhere before they could receive communion in that denomination. Who do we welcome to celebrate communion with us? And why do we do that? Because it's not our invitation to give, is it? It's not a denomination's invitation to give. It's not a local church's invitation to give. It's not a preacher's invitation to give. It's the invitation of Jesus. And Jesus welcomes everyone. Who does Jesus welcome? Well, let's look so that this is not just Jacob. Come to me, verse 28. Come to me, who? All. Come to me, all. You who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens. Come to me, all of you who have been excluded from the church. That's what he's getting at. I'm not making this up. This is not Jacob's message this morning. If anything I say is of me, my sincere prayer right this second is you will forget it before you leave this place. If I am saying anything that is of God, I pray it is indelibly etched in your heart and in your mind. What Jesus is getting at is the religious practices that prevented people from getting to him. Based on orthodoxies, do you believe this? Based on orthopraxies, right practices. Orthodoxy means right doctrine. Orthopraxy means right practice, right actions. There were people who believed you were not in the presence of God unless you worshiped here. There were others that believed that you were not in the presence of God unless you worshiped here. They had man-made traditions and practices. There were some people for whom, by the particulars of their birth, were excluded from the faithful community. And they were carrying heavy burdens because the religious authority said, you're outside. You don't count. You don't belong. The religious authorities. And Jesus comes and says, all of you who are weary and heavy burdened, come to me. Come to me. Come to me. My yoke is good, not just easy, it's good. My burden is light. I'm humble. I'm gentle. I'm the embodiment of grace, and you will find rest. Come to me. I'm the one who was sent to tell you that you are loved with an infinite love. You are accepted right where you are. If you never change, I'm going to love you forever. When you realize how much I love you, you won't be able to help but to change. That is his message from beginning to last. When I walked in the back this morning, and it can be an overwhelming thing. I've told you this before. It can be an overwhelming thing to do this on a Sunday morning. I'm not giving a speech. I'm aware that there are people in this room who sometimes we're here because this is what we do, and there are times when we're here and it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. You know, there are sometimes when I walk into this place where it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. There have been times when I'm on the phone on the way to this place saying, I'm so grateful that this is what I get to do, because there are times in my life, for various reasons, where sometimes it's hard to breathe in and breathe out. Have you ever been there? But we do need to be reminded and assured of what is true, but it can be overwhelming knowing that we're not playing. We played the flute for you. You did not dance. We wailed and you did not mourn. One of the things he's getting at is that some people are just playing. They're just playing. They're playing religion. And sometimes it's a group thing. We're all kind of playing and we're all kind of playing along. And sometimes we wonder if in our hearts, if we are just playing along, is this stuff real or not? When I walked in, Alan said, you know who's here today? And I smiled, and I knew what he was going to say, and we said at the same time, Jesus. And if he isn't, we all need to pack up and go home. We're not playing church, are we? We're not going through the motions. We're here because we want to know who God is, as God is. And Jesus says, forget the pretense. If the doctrines lead you closer to me, then observe the doctrines. If the religious practices lead you to me, then continue the religious practices. But if ever those doctrines and those practices, I don't care how pious they seem, if they ever come in conflict with the need of a human being, scrap the doctrine, scrap the practice, scrap the observance. And he did it consistently. He always placed human beings before a doctrine or what was considered even moral. He always placed human beings first. Let me hasten to conclude with two things. One, when we are invited into this life of grace, we're invited to a life of exchange. We exchange one affliction for another. There's no out, I'm sorry to tell you, in this lifetime of afflictions. But the affliction changes. When we become aware of our condition, and sometimes it takes some people longer than others, when we become aware of just how much we need God, sometimes there is a crisis. And I would call it a God-given crisis. We become aware, acutely aware, that we need God. And sometimes we recognize that chasm between how good God is and the condition we are in. And sometimes it can feel overwhelming. Could God accept someone like me? And the answer is yes. And the answer is we recognize, we experience God's love, we know that we are forgiven and will continually be forgiven, and it's no longer the fear of the alternative that constrains our behavior, it's how much we love God that constrains our behavior. We're no longer afflicted by the question of whether or not God loves us or we are beyond God's love. But now we're afflicted with a different kind of affliction. And there's no out. I'll give you an example. I had the opportunity to take my youngest daughter, Evie, and one of her friends to see my mother in Georgia a week and a half or so ago. And while I was there, I was able to catch up with a few of my friends. And one friend of mine and I, we went on a pretty long walk. And I don't know why, it's a matter of habit. I'm always looking to make eye contact with people when I'm walking wherever I am, and I'm always wanting to speak and say hi and smile. I just feel like that too is part of our calling. You never know how much a smile can change people's day. Someone recognizing them as a human being. There are people who go through this world who feel invisible, like they don't count. I've noticed that there are particular groups, first generation, second generation immigrants, I've noticed on a regular basis how they often don't make contact, eye contact. And my hunch is that they're so used to being invisible, people not speaking to them. It's important for us to try to acknowledge one another's humanity. There are other religious traditions where people will honor the divine when they see people. What if we could try to do that with our eyes? We were walking, and I noticed this woman had been walking, but she was walking, it was labored. And I smiled and spoke to her, and she didn't respond. And I remember thinking, she's in pain. And it affected me. That's the grace of God. My friend wanted to stop by the shoe repair place, one of the very few that's still in existence. Because my friend had stopped by there, and this particular gentleman had been in this family-owned business for decades. My friend had heard his story, and we stopped in there. My friend wanted to introduce the shoe repair man to me and me to the shoe repair man. And he had such a bright spirit. You could see it in his eyes. He had such a bright spirit. And there was another gentleman who was sitting down. And you could tell that he didn't like the presence of my friend and me in this shop. These happened to be two elderly African-American men. And I wondered what the one who was sitting down had experienced over his lifetime. I grew up in that town. I know what relationships were like. I know that the African-American population was concentrated in two different parts of town out of necessity, and that racial tensions were as strong where I grew up as they are anywhere. And I wondered what that gentleman had experienced over time. After our walk, it was mid-afternoon, and we went for a late lunch, early dinner. We were in a pizza place. It was a pizza place that has a bar, like a bar, you know, booze, right there at the front where the windows are. And we could sit at the bar, or we could go toward the back where there were no windows. What would a good Christian do in a situation like that? We bellied up at the bar. And God knows I'm so glad we did. See, Jesus says, you're worried about the wrong things. You're worried about appearances. You're worried about who's going to see you where. They call me a drunkard. They call me a glutton. Hanging out with the sinners. And this man walked in, and he sat down, and he had a pretty fresh tattoo that covered his whole arm. And the reason I know that, because that arm was shaved and the other arm had hair on it. You're pretty observant, Jake. How are you? I'm all right. You okay? I just came from the hospital. My daughter was hit in a head-on collision. I didn't know where else to go. Broke her jaw. They think she's going to be stable. She's a daddy's girl. You exchange one affliction for another. You're no longer worried about how people perceive you, whether you're righteous enough, if you believe the right things, or you've got every controversial issue down. You stop caring about that. There are human beings in front of us everywhere we go that need to know that they are children of God. Let God take care of the rest. It's not our job to tell everybody what they have to believe in order to get to heaven. It's not our job to tell everybody how they're supposed to behave in order for them to get to heaven. Our job is to introduce them to the one who says, come to me. My burden is easy. My yoke is light. You are loved. You will always be loved. Let that love change your life. That's my prayer for you. That's my prayer for me. That's my prayer for all of God's children. I invite you to stand as you're able. God is good all the time, and all the time, God is good. If you've ever been worried about how much God loves you, stop worrying today. If you've ever wondered if you are beyond God's love, stop worrying today. whatever's hindering you from coming to God through His Son, let it go. However God has inspired you through the course of these wonderful worship leaders and their songs, and let's thank the people in that technology booth that we don't see, but they do so much. Our greeters, the ones who come early, our elders who come early and pray for this congregation and this city and this church and all churches in our world. And thank you for your ministry of presence here today. This service would not be what it is without you. Never underestimate the power of your ministry of presence. However God calls you to respond as we sing our song of commitment, I encourage you to respond. Now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding and comprehension, the peace we can know when we come to the one who is gentle and humble in heart, the peace we can experience when we let go of all that would try to say to us that we are beyond God's love, the peace we experience as we become about God's mission of sharing God's love with everyone with whom we encounter. May that peace guard and sustain our hearts, our minds, our spirits this day and forevermore. Amen.
All God's children sit together.